There are two visions for self-driving cars today. One of them, this is a symbol that the Toyota team uses, which I really love. They call it the mobility teammate concept. In this particular model, the car is a virtual co-pilot, that arguably drives even better than you do. It drives better than you do because it's paying attention all the time. It's paying attention because it's a computer. It sees all around itself. And if we could create the technology to make it possible to drive by itself, this virtual co-pilot will keep you out of harm's way. I kind of imagine this idea where your car essentially has this virtual bubble around it, virtual force field around it. You never run into anything else around it. It knows exactly where to go, and it keeps you out of harm's way. The second vision is a car that has no drivers at all. In both of these examples, the computing capability necessary to achieve autonomy, self-driving capability, is going to be far greater than anything that's currently available. And we'll talk about that in a second and make it clear why that's so. In both of these visions, if we could realize it, the contribution we can make to society is really, really wonderful and great. And so our vision is to create the computing platform necessary to make this possible. The self-driving program loop basically works like this. There's a sensing part. You get all kinds of sensors. You want sensors that can see during daytime, during nighttime, during rain, during fog, all of the different types of conditions that you could possibly imagine surrounding the car you would like to be able to sense. It could be radars, it could be LIDARs, it could be cameras, it could be ultrasonics. You have inertial measurement units, you have GPS. All of these sensors contribute to sensing where you are and where what's around you. There are several different blocks that I'll talk about. The top block is the map, the precision map. That map was generated in advance. It was done through scanning, probably LIDAR scanning. You see these cars that are running around, mapping the world in 3D, measuring the world, and precisely mapping every part. In the middle, that block is called localized. That has something to do with where you are. Based on what you measure, based on what you perceive, we have to figure out where you are within a few centimeters. The bottom block is perception. Perception, seeing everything around you, whether it's during daytime, driving directly into sunlight, in snow and fog and rain, whenever it is, we need to perceive where you are and what's around you. And based on all of that information, we have to figure out a way to plan your path. So starting from where you are, you perceive the world. We figure out a way to calibrate that with a pre-known map. And then based on everything that's moving around you, your movement, where you are in the world, all the movement of all the other objects around you, whether it's pedestrians crossing or bicyclists or motorcyclists or cars that are moving all around you, you need to find a way to find your path. Okay, that's called path planning. You do this in basically an infinite loop. You just keep doing this continuously. You're perceiving the world continuously. You're comparing it against the map continuously. You're localizing continuously. And you're planning the next step continuously. And we do this as fast as we can so that we can control the car and make the car drive and path plan so that it keeps you 100 harms away. Well, it turns out all of this is relatively hard to do. Each and every single one of these blocks are hard to do. Perception is hard, localization is hard, path planning is hard, figuring out what sensors to use, using the right amount of sensors, but modestly so that we can make it cost effective, hard to do. All of these components are hard to do. And there's innovation, R&D, discovery, and every single component of it. Self-driving cars is hard. Well, it turns out that driving is hard. Now, when you think about highway driving, we've constrained the problem enough that highway driving has become relatively easy per se. I mean, to the point where grandparents can drive. We all largely stay in our lane. We're traveling about the same speed. And so relative to each other, we're hardly moving. Highway driving is relatively easy. And even then, there are many conditions by which highway driving hasn't been solved. We have highway driving in all kinds of conditions. If a truck carrying some junk, some parts of it fell off onto a road, that happens, as you know, pretty much all the time. And when that happens, your car has to do the right thing, take evasive action, and keep you out of harm's way. So even highway driving is hard. But we can't realize the full potential of our vision unless we can solve also city driving. Now, in city driving, almost none of us are going in the same direction. You've got cars coming sideways. You've got people walking all over the place. Bikers are, of course, in the same road that you are, motorcyclists. And people are, of course, sometimes following the rules and largely not. And so you can't read a manual from the DMV and figure out exactly what program to write into your car to cause it to drive properly. And so city driving is very chaotic, it's very, very hard, and the perception problem, as you can imagine, explodes. You have to perceive all kinds of cars, all different types of people, all different types of bicyclists, all different types of environments. Sometimes the road is being fixed, sometimes there's construction going on. Sometimes the lane is painted over from a new lane, and all of a sudden, the number of lanes that you look at with your car is rather confusing for the car. And so everything around that environment is chaotic. It's complex, it's unpredictable, and oftentimes it's even hazardous. So self-driving cars are hard.